On Wednesday, Grant Robertson will make his valedictory speech as he prepares to leave Parliament for his new role as Vice-Chancellor of Otago University. Robertson was Finance Minister for two terms and at a critical juncture in modern New Zealand history, overseeing the pandemic's economic response. I sat down with him in Parliament's Grand Hall and reflected on his 15 years as an MP.
Can I be cheeky and just check if the shackles are off in this interview or not? Is taking GST off fresh fruit and vegetables a good piece of public policy?
Well, it didn't work, did it?
Is that a no?
Oh, look, I mean, I think I can understand 100% where Chris Hipkins was coming from with that. It was a way of making cost of living relief real. People will be well aware about what I thought about that policy.
Let's go back. When you made your maiden speech in the House, your granddad was sitting up in the pews. I think he was 89 years old at that time. He himself was a former Labor candidate, and you spoke about your shared ambition to make New Zealand a fairer and more equal place. It is a big question, but if you look back at the New Zealand of 2008, when you started here, and compare it with the New Zealand of today, is it a fairer and more equal place?
In some ways, yes, and in some ways, no, because the big event that occurred between then and now was the 9 years of the John Key-led government. And in that period of time, what we spent as a country on the things that would make us fairer reduced significantly. And when we came in 2017, things were further back from where we were. So is it fairer because we built a lot more state houses? Yes, I think it is. We did lift a lot of kids out of poverty, and then we banged in to the inflation, the big inflation spike, which has caused some of those numbers to come back a little bit, but we did do good things there. We restored the rates of main benefits to where they were at the equivalent levels before the mother of all budgets in 1991. So we did good things to make the country a fairer place. But there's an old saying in Labor Party politics that the journey to social justice never ends, and there's still a lot more to do there.
Are you a regrets guy?
Not really, no.
Okay, well, reflecting on your time as Finance Minister, with the usual caveat that you felt you made the best decisions with the information you had available at the time, what decisions stand out as being things that you might do differently?
I'm not a regrets guy, and therefore I don't regret this, but I think I've changed my mind, and that's around the level of public debt that's sustainable. This is probably not going to excite the viewers enormously, but it's really important. In 2017, we had to prove our bona fides on running the economy, and James Shaw and I actually came up with the budget responsibility rules together for Labor and the Greens. And that meant that we were going to keep our level of net debt at 20% of GDP. That's historically been something governments have tried to do, and New Zealand does need a lower level of public debt than some other countries around the world because we have natural disasters and we are a small country. But keeping slavishly to a percentage like that means we're not investing enough in our infrastructure. And that's the bottom line. We should use our balance sheet more and better to invest in infrastructure. And over time, we did increase that, and you'll hear a lot from the current government about where the levels of debt are at. But what increasing our debt has done has enabled us to invest more in transport, more into health and education capital, more into the things that we need to underpin the kind of society and economy we want. And I think it's very clear to me now that if we were to ever go back down to those sorts of percentages of debt, we would be denying future generations the things that they need.
It's really interesting. You are doubling down on spending, because if you go back to that initial COVID response, right, and I think a lot of people agreed at the time that the best fiscal approach was to spend to try and avoid the kind of horror scenario that Treasury was pointing out you could be facing, 10% unemployment, something like that. But in the years after COVID, even when the books were pretty good and unemployment was at 3 point something, you kept on delivering budgets with massive deficits. Did New Zealanders get value for money for that spend?
Yeah, I think what New Zealanders got is what we needed to do, which is invest in public services, invest in the education system, pay teachers properly, make sure we right the wrongs of the past on pay equity deals. Jack, we measure things in New Zealand as a percentage of GDP, and the reason we do that is so you can do it consistently over a period of time. When we look at the amount of money that we were spending on, you know, core crown expenses, when we came in 2017, it was 27% of GDP. It's sitting up around sort of 32, and it's going to come down a bit. If we keep spending around that 27%, that's austerity. That means there's not enough money. And when people complain about the health system, they complain about how long they might have to wait in an emergency department, they're worried about the quality of their kids' school, that's caused by us not investing enough. And so I do stand by what we did there. Were there the odd thing where, you know, things didn't play out the way we wanted? Sure, that
like
happens
what?
To every government. Well, it happens to every government,
sure.
And it's a day-to-day
basis. What stands
out
for you?
There's not a particular example, but I'm...
But it's the quality of the spend, right? You say that the spend is important when it comes to public services, but the quality of the spend is the thing that concerns
so
a lot of critics.
Let's take a thing about, hospitals, health capital. I remember Jacinda saying to me once, you know, do I really have to go to the opening of another kind of elevator? Because we were doing the basics. We were having to go back and reinvest in there. And I'd say one thing about that, which is I think we need to be clearer with people about the length of time the rebuilding, for example, of the health system's going to take. You know, we were being judged as soon as we'd done the reforms, where's the improvement? And the reality is that it's a 10-year program to get that health system back. So we could have been better around expectation management on some of that, for sure.
What about stuff like the cost of living payment?
Yeah, I mean, 98-point-something% of the cost of living payment went to where exactly where it should have, and 1-point-something% went to places, to people it shouldn't.
Inflationary?
No, I wouldn't say so. And if it was, no more so than any other form of government spending. This is something I want to talk about, Jack, which is the contribution of government spending to inflation. There are a lot of forces in what is causing inflation, and the political debate can be turned into a cartoon about it's the government spending that's the big factor in that. There are a lot of different forces on that, and that level of government spending on the COVID income relief payment is minuscule in terms of the whole economy and what causes inflation.
So how much responsibility do you take for the inflation spike?
We were part of a global situation where inflation was rising.
Sure, Reserve Bank plays a role as well,
yeah,
but what's your responsibility?
We invested significantly in COVID, and this is where you don't get to do the governing in hindsight thing, that actually we took the decisions we took, and in those years when COVID finished, budget 2022, budget 2023, we were rebuilding public services.
But you were doing things like taking money from the COVID fund to pay for cameras on fishing boats. What we were tangentially related at best.
Yeah, so that was right at the beginning, and that was part of the COVID response and recovery fund. And you do have to take yourself back, Jack, to those times. We were thinking about a situation where not only were we going to have to respond to COVID, but we were going to see the economy really slow down. And we did invest in a number of areas that were about stimulating recovery. I stand by those decisions. And actually, when you go out into provincial New Zealand and you see some of the things that we did, they've had really good, positive benefits.
I guess the point at large is that at some point, all of that debt, which you think needs to be higher than you initially thought when you took over as finance minister, has to be repaid. And the debt has to be repaid by younger generations who don't have the benefit of the assets that older generations had. And those are the older generations that benefited from massive asset inflation, in part because of your policies and the COVID response.
We definitely have to spread the cost of investing in important assets over a long period of time.
Do you accept that fundamental point? That one result of New Zealand's economic response was a wealth transfer to homeowners who are overwhelmingly likely to be older, while tens of billions in debt is going to have to be repaid over younger people's working lives. Do you accept that point?
I accept the first part of that point particularly. I do accept that, because one of the things that happened was that in making sure that we bolstered the markets in New Zealand, it did have the effect of those who already have assets seeing those assets rise in value. Again, I'd invite you to have a look around the world and see whether that was really any different anywhere because of the way money markets work. But remember, we were getting reports March, April 2020 that told us that financial markets around the world were collapsing, bond markets weren't actually going to be able to respond, and we did need to do what we did. Now, you've pointed yourself out, the Reserve Bank made those decisions, we gave them the tools to make those decisions. But when you look back and you look at it now, it's a very different view from where we were in 2020. The other thing I would say is by far the greatest beneficiaries of the fiscal response were workers and small business owners and sole traders, because they were the people who actually got their businesses to be able to carry on. The big businesses, sure, they got some benefit. The homeowners, they got some benefit. But when you actually break down the numbers, small businesses, people keeping their jobs and having sole traders, artists and others who could actually access that funding, they're the ones who really benefited.
The Welfare Expert Advisory Group recommendations, tax reform, Three Waters, the Māori Health Authority, the resource management reforms, income insurance, Auckland Light Rail, Te Pūkenga, media reforms. A lot of people will look back at the previous government and note that even with an historic majority, there is a huge amount of stuff you either didn't tackle or ultimately didn't stick. Why?
Well, some of those things didn't stick because we lost the election. Some of them didn't stick because the economy didn't grow the way that we wanted it to, and there were other priorities that had to come along. And you have to accept that when you're governing. Some of that COVID got in the way and meant that we didn't get as far on a project as we would have liked. It is the reality of being in government that not everything you try ends up finishing. You won't want me to do it now, but I can start doing the counter list of the number of state houses and the number of apprentices.
Sure, but those are massive projects though, right? And I suppose the unique thing is that you had a majority. And I can only imagine that from your position over the last couple of weeks, it has been a pretty galling experience to sit there and watch the sword of Damocles fall on all of those big projects. Are there lessons for the Labor Party in the future when governing that would make some of those big reforms more likely to stick?
I'm always really interested by what people think the mandate was that we got in 2020. And when we got a mandate on the basis of a policy platform that we put forward, it wasn't a mandate just to do anything. Just because we had the majority didn't mean we could go, forget what we campaigned on, let's just do a whole lot of other things. We had a particular mandate and we tried to drive forward on that. In terms of what the lessons are that are learned, I do think it's valid to say we probably bit off more than we could chew. But that's the nature of being in the Labor Party. And funnily enough, it's one of the reasons why I like being in the Labor Party, is because we do chase down the big issues that need to be solved. And ultimately, this government will need to resolve Three Waters. They will need to work out how the vocational education system can work better. We will, over the long term, have to think about what we do to create something more permanent for people when they lose their jobs. Those things aren't going away. And I'm proud to have been part of a Labor government that had a go at them. Didn't succeed on all of them, but did a lot of other good things in the meantime.
Upon reflection, do you think there was too much of a focus on maintaining political capital at times at the expense of progressing enduring change?
That is a very tricky balance. You do have to maintain political capital, because one of the answers to the question you've just asked me is, why didn't we finish things? It's because we got voted out after 6 years, not nine or not 12. So you're always trying to balance, how do we make sure that we can stay here and how do we make sure that we can achieve change? And there will be occasions and people who will say, you should have done this, you should have done that. I remain proud of what we did, but there's definitely unfinished business.
So do you think you struck that balance right?
I think for most part, yeah.
There were times when you didn't?
Oh, there were times when it was hard. I mean, people know. I mean, I proposed the income insurance scheme. You know, there are things that I wanted to see happen, the taxation changes. But I'm also realistic, Jack, about the world that we live in and the fact that we've got to bring New Zealanders with us if we want to make these changes.
Being the political boffin you are, do you think if you'd gone to the election with those tax changes as you wanted them, the result would have been any different?
I don't necessarily think Labor would have won.
But do you think it would have been different?
Might have been slightly different, but I don't think Labor
would have won. How different? Just explain how you think it would
have been. Look, you know, my view is that I think had we been able to go forward with a more concrete tax policy about where we were going, that would have seen, you know, some people receive tax cuts on the basis of others, particularly the wealthier, and pay more, that would have given us something very concrete to campaign on. But like you say, I've been around politics a long time. I've been through a lot of elections. Mm. My gut feeling is Labor still would not have won the election.
While it was pretty rare for him to talk about it that much in public, Grant Robertson is the most senior, openly LGBT politician in New Zealand history.
Twice you formally stood for your party's leadership, 2013 and 2014. This is a bit of a delicate question. Do you think if you weren't gay, you would have been leader of the Labor Party at some point?
It's a really tough question to answer. I'm not so worried about being delicate. I think in 2013, it was an issue in the campaign, internally within the Labor Party. And I do think it probably affected that, although whether I would have been able to win that one even without that, I'm not sure. By the time we got to 2014, it was less of an issue the second time round, but it continued to be there. But I'm not going to dwell too much on that. I think New Zealand's changed a lot in the decades since then, which is great. I still think there's some distance to go for us to get to a place where people can be who they want to be, live their lives freely and be appreciated for who they are in New Zealand. But in a political sense, yeah, I think a lot's changed in those 10 years.
Did that affect you? It must have affected you after that time, if you felt that that was like maybe a determining factor.
I'm not sure I'd say determining. I'm trying to be really straight up with you, so to speak, on this, which is that it was a factor, I know that, but I'm not sure it was everything. There was a lot of other things that
except
were going
that the
on
margins,
as well.
Especially in 2014, by which you lost, were very small indeed.
Look, the day after I lost that 24 leadership election, I remember sitting down and saying, I'm not going to do that again. And I actually didn't come to politics to be the leader of a party. I came to achieve some things in some areas, and I'm going to focus on doing that. And then I became the finance spokesperson, which gave me an amazing opportunity and privilege to be able to work on those issues. And I genuinely put it out of my mind. And then when Jacinda took the leadership in 2017, I was able to be there and support my friend in doing that. That was all enormously fulfilling. And so I'm not sitting here thinking much about what happened in 2013 or 2014.
When Jacinda Ardern announced she was going to stand down, come on, you must have considered it.
Oh, for sure, absolutely.
And so what was the determining factor? Did you poll it?
No, I don't know if the party did, but I certainly didn't.
You don't know if the party did?
I don't think they did. They didn't have time. look, Jacinda, and as is on the record, Jacinda and I had been talking towards the end of 2022 about what she wanted to do. And so clearly I also went away over the summer to have a think about what I wanted to do. And I'd been up close to that job, and I knew exactly what it took to do it, and I knew that I didn't have that. I wanted to contribute still, but I knew what that job meant for me, for my family, for the commitment that was required, and I knew I didn't have it. And I thought it would be dishonest to chase a job that I knew I couldn't give the 110, 120% that was required. And I was also confident in Chris Hipkins' ability to do the job. So I went through all of that, and of course I thought about it, but in the end, you know, I felt the right decision for me, for my family, for the party, was not to put myself up.
We hosted 3 Women's World Cups under your watch, the Rugby, Cricket and Football World Cups, codes in which the men's game has traditionally dominated. Was there pushback that we didn't see from those who felt that hosting women's events wasn't really worth it?
We've never had a women and girls in sport strategy until we became government and I became minister. And there was pushback from some within the community about all the elements of that strategy. Hosting the big events was one of them. But one of the other things we did was ask all national sporting organisations to have at least 40% women on their boards. There was definitely pushback on that. And I felt
Which codes?
I'm not going to say which ones, but I felt really vindicated when I was at an event last year in a fairly traditional code, and one of the board members came to me and said, we make better decisions now because we've got that diversity on our board. And we did link it to funding, and there was one, rugby, who didn't quite make it, but they have now. And I'm really proud of all of that. Those events, those pinnacle events, were incredible. But the stuff that actually gives me the most pleasure is when I see the player numbers that have increased in girls cricket and women's football and women's rugby. And I love sport. It's such a great way of bringing our communities together. And I always felt uncomfortable if we were sort of excluding half the community from that amazing opportunity. And I think we've done amazing things, more to do, but I'm really, really proud of that work.
When you first became the finance spokesperson, you thought a lot about the future of work. Social insurance is perhaps a material policy that evolved from some of that thinking. How do you think that AI is going to disrupt the future of work in New Zealand?
It's huge, and every industry, including the one I'm going to in terms of universities, has to be clear-eyed about where AI fits. We can't stop it. There's no way of saying we're not going to engage with it. We have to engage with it as a country, and as, in my case, in the universities. I think the beauty of that Future of Work project was the thing that I heard time and time again from CEOs and others was the technical knowledge wasn't so much what they cared about. What they cared about were the skills that the people brought, the so-called soft skills, you know. Are you good at analysing problems? Are you resilient? How do you work with others? Can you see something out, a creative solution? I want to look at AI in that way and say, well, it's here, we have to obviously put regulation around it, do what we need to do, but let's focus on how we create the great human beings who are going to be able to use AI for good.
What more would you have done on wellbeing?
Some of it's quite technical, but
give us the broad themes.
Yeah. I'd like to see government departments work together a lot more on the big, messy, complex problems the world's facing. You know, climate change, child poverty, housing. We started that work.
Stuff's still pretty siloed, right?
It is, very. And, you know, but where we have brought people together, we've seen great outcomes. We now fund all of our justice agencies, you know, police, the Ministry of Justice, courts, corrections, on a three-year rolling basis with one set of priorities. And it was an amazing thing to be part of, you know, to hear the police go, we don't want that funding, we'd rather it went here to prevent someone ending up in front of us. New Zealanders don't care which agencies are providing the services that they get. They just want them provided. And that breaking down of the silo on the basis of what are the key things in our well-being, we made some really positive starts, but that was a COVID interruptus moment for us. And I really hope, despite the fact that it might be associated with me or with Labor, that the current government actually does carry that on.
You said you didn't have the gas to take on the PM job. But you do have the gas to be the Vice-Chancellor of a major university. What is it going to take to get the tertiary sector in New Zealand sorted?
Better collaboration. We're a small country. We've got fantastic universities, actually, and we actually, relatively speaking, rank quite highly in the world in them. But that small country needs to see those universities build on their strengths and work together more, and then take that out to the world as well. Secondly, I think we've got to really value tertiary education and the staff who work within it. We've got extraordinary people, Jack, and I know you do interviews around the country. The connection between the business sector and our tertiary sector needs to improve, but the amazing work that's done by our researchers and our teachers and our university needs to be highlighted. I've got a big job to do at Otago. Everyone knows that there are stresses across the university sector financially, but there's so much opportunity, and I think if we can actually get a more collaborative sector going, we'll go a long way to harnessing that opportunity.
Outside of your caucus, who is the best debater in the House?
Outside of the Labor caucus, James Shaw.
How's it going to feel standing up there for the last time? Are you a sentimental kind of guy?
I think I'm going to cry.
Really?
Yeah, I do. I've been drafting up my valedictory speech, and there's bits of it that I think are going to be interesting to deliver. I've been in and around this building for 2 decades. I've been thinking about the political world for a long time. I care about what we do here, and I'm ready to go, but that doesn't mean, it doesn't make me emotional thinking about leaving.
What bits are going to make you cry?
You'll have to watch the speech, Jack.
Thank you very much. Good luck.
Cheers.
It's former Finance Minister and former Deputy Prime Minister Grant Robertson. After the interview, we took a few minutes and he showed me one of his favourite spots in Parliament.
Where
it's a spot most people don't see. It's called the Rainbow Room, and it celebrates contributions of LGBT MPs from across the political spectrum and the progress that has been made from homosexual law reform through to same-sex marriage. You can see that exchange on our YouTube page.